And then here's Joshua. Joshua got upset. Moses, you ought to stop them. Moses said, I wish all of God's people were prophets. Why would I go and stop them if they're doing a work for the same spirit that's on these men is in that camp? We can't bottle him up and think we can just contain him to our little octagon. The Spirit gives gifts as he sees fit. He said it this morning. I might be an eye, but I'm going to be the best eye in the kingdom. I might be a foot, but guess what? I'm going to walk just as God has commanded me to walk. I might be a hand. I'll shake hands with the homeless or the president. It does not matter to me. The Spirit gives gifts as he sees fit. And nobody really understands what God is doing. We have to let God be God. Nobody understood how God can use Cyrus the Great to set the Israelites free from the Babylonians. Amen. Isaiah didn't understand how God could use the Assyrians as a tool in his hand to punish the wickedness of Israel. Amen. Amen. Nobody can really understand how God can use a donkey to speak to a prophet to keep the prophet from being killed by the anger of the Lord. Amen. Nobody really understands how Jesus, amen, could cast out a legion of demons from a man and then deputize him and send him to the Decapolis and say, go home and tell your family all the great things that the Lord has done for you. Who are we to tell God who to use? What matters are the essentials. Don't split hairs about the y'all sprinkle, y'all immerse. Y'all do this, y'all do. I'm not splitting hairs about that. What matters are the essentials. Ask this question. What are we saying about the essentials of Christian faith? What are we saying about essential Christian doctrine? What are we saying about those things that line up with Scripture? If it lines up with Scripture and is properly, amen, and is properly, we have a proper theology. What are we saying about those things? Because, see, that's where we divide when those things are out of line. What are we saying about Jesus? Are we saying that he's the Son of the living God? High five. We're on the same page. Are we saying that he's the only way to the Father? High five. We're all the same. Are we saying that there's no other way to be saved except through faith in Jesus Christ? High five. We're on the same page. What are we saying about Jesus? Are we saying that there's no other name under heaven by which men must be saved? Those are primary issues. Are we saying that there's one God who exists in three persons and not three modes? Amen. The Bible clearly, the word Trinity is not there. But we clearly see evidence that there is a Father, there is a Son, and that there is a Holy Ghost. That's evident. What are we saying about that? Because if you tell me that is one God and he just moves from mold to mold, I beg to differ, because Christ died on the cross and he looked up to the Father and said, Father, why have you forsaken me? Is that in the Bible? High five, we're on the same page. Amen. What are we saying about these things? And see, this is where the problem comes in, because we'll jump over that and start looking for a little piece of lint on somebody's jacket. Amen. So we get hung up on the secondary, but we forget about the primary. The primary is this: the only way to be saved is through faith in Jesus Christ. And by putting our trust in Jesus Christ. Amen. Listen now. What was the response of Jesus? Verse 39. Look at what it says. But Jesus says, don't hinder him. Don't prevent him. Don't get in his way. Don't even step foot over there trying to stop him. Why? Because there's no one who will perform a miracle in my name and be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Jesus says it like this in verse 40. If he's not against us, he's on our side. That's what that means when he says if he's not against us, he's for us. If he's not against us, he's on our side. If he was against us, we know it because, first of all, he wouldn't be doing works in my name. He'd be scattering and not gathering. That's what he said. The one who's not for us is against us. He doesn't gather with us. He scatters. And so Jesus understood this. The harvest is ripe, but the workers are few. Amen. Now let me take this to a different place, and I'm almost out of your way. What about those wolves in sheep's clothing? Do we receive those? Amen. Do we let those come in and greet them with the joy of Jesus? What about those? Because Jesus said, I said this earlier, he said it himself, that many will come in my name, and deceive many. So I ask this question, how do we know if they are on our side? You have to ask that question when you read this scripture. How do you know if one is on your side? First of all, let's say it again, what are they saying about Jesus? See, you can't blaspheme Jesus and say you love Jesus at the same time. You can't speak evil of Jesus and go out and try to work deeds of power in his name at the same time. That's why he said, no one who will perform a miracle in my name will soon be able to speak evil of me. The Bible says this. It says, no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Spirit of God. And no one can say Jesus be accursed if he's under the influence of the Spirit of God. Amen. Secondly, how do we know they're with us? We look at their fruit. The Bible says it clearly. Jesus said it out of his own mouth. You'll know a tree how? By how pretty it is? No, by the fruit that it bears. 1 John chapter 3. Verses 7 through 8, little children, make sure no one deceives you. The one who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he, Jesus, is righteous. Listen now, the one who practices sin is of the devil. Amen. For the devil has sinned from the beginning. What do I mean by looking at the fruit? If I see a person, I don't care how much they say Jesus, amen, if their life doesn't reflect Jesus, something is missing. Amen. I don't care how many leaves are on the tree. If there's no fruit on the tree, something is missing. And he says the one who practices sin is of the devil. What does that mean? It means the one whose lifestyle is a lifestyle of sin. He's of the devil. I don't care how big the church is. If he practices sin, he's of the devil. I don't care how many members are in the congregation. If you practice sin, you are of the devil. It's point blank. It's period. It's right there in the word. 1 John 3:10. By this, the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. Listen now. Anyone who does not practice righteousness is not of God. Nor the one who does not love his brother.
That's right.
How can you say you love God and hate your brother?
Right.
Amen. If you really want to understand this thing, I encourage you to read the book of 1 John. It's only 5 short little chapters. It's a beautiful, beautiful essay. It tells us how to know a wolf in sheep's clothing from one who's on our side. Thirdly, time will tell. How will we know if they're truly with us? Can I give you some advice? We'll let God figure it out. Jesus says a day is coming when many are going to come and say, Lord, Lord, I prophesied in your name. I cast out demons in your name. You see it in your name. I did this in your name. I did that in your name. And his reply is the coldest reply I've ever heard. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. In other words, you who practice iniquity. You thought you were skating by. You thought you were getting away with something. I just used you for my glory. Amen. But you didn't get away. You can't put up a front with Jesus. You can't tell Jesus, I'm doing it, Jesus, and then on the backside or when the lights go off, something else is happening. No, he says, depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. I never knew you.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
What's the final analysis? Verse 41. Whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because of your name as followers of Christ, truly I say to you, he will not lose his reward. What does Jesus say here? That there are rewards attached for those who support the cause of Christ. Amen. He says, whoever gives you a cup of, how simple is a cup of water? It seems simple, but if you're dying of thirst in the desert, it's the best cup of water you ever had in your life. Amen. How simple is a peanut butter and jelly sandwich? It's easy to go and make until you're starving and somebody shows up with one. Amen. What are you going to say? I don't eat peanut butter? No. I'm hungry as all get out. Think you got another one? Amen. He says, whoever gives you a cup of water, listen now, because of your name as followers of Christ, we already talked about this. As followers of Christ, we will be persecuted. We will need assistance from those who are in the family of God. Amen. Matthew 10:40-42, he who receives you receives me. And he who receives me receives the one who sent me. Verse 41. He who receives a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward. He who receives a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward. Listen now, verse 42. And whoever in the name of a disciple gives to one of these little ones even a cup of cold water, truly I say to you, he shall not lose his reward. Amen. Being a servant for Jesus and serving those who serve Jesus. That's what Jesus is talking about here. I think of men like Nicodemus who stood up to Jesus in the midst of all of the Pharisees waiting to condemn. Nicodemus said, hey, wait a minute. Shouldn't we at least give him a trial and hear him out? I think of men like Joseph of Arimathea. You know, these are rich men with lots to lose. And I think about somebody like him showing up and saying, I'll take the body, Pilate. Let me go and give him a proper burial. You think about someone like Simon the Cyrene who was just standing there as Jesus was carrying his cross up the hill and he was too weak to carry it. So Simon ended up carrying that cross. What about his reward? I think about that, and I think about men who and women who gave their all for Jesus, who stood at the foot of the cross, even though the religious leaders and the persecutors were standing there too. I think about those people who let Paul down in a basket when he was running for his life. Amen. I think about those who visited Paul while he was in prison and were not ashamed to be associated with him, even in spite of his chains. We get all worked up over the wrong stuff. We should be getting worked up over Jesus. We should be getting worked up over the fact that someone needs us, and even if I give one just a cup of water, that's not asking a lot, I won't lose my reward. Amen. The doors of the church are open. If there's one today who does not know Jesus Christ and the pardon of your sins, nothing here but air and opportunity. Amen. He wants to know you. It's not that Jesus is looking for a reason to say, I never knew you. He wants to know who, well, let me take that back. He knows who you are. He wants you to know who he is. Amen. He knows the numbers of hairs on all of our heads. Amen. Is there one today who seeks to give their life to Christ, who wants to be saved? So all we can say, everything we want to say, but in the name of Jesus, there is salvation. Amen.